Well, this is not. So the debate is about obesity. We are all hungry now, so we will probably understand things. It's all in the mind. Next 5 minutes, I want to just conclude by saying it may be gut, because that's where we all are eagerly waiting. Talk about obesity. We are still number one in terms of undernutrition. We are underweight population. In terms of obesity, we stand fifth. Chinese have overtaken the Americans. They are number one. We are at fifth place, so better we stay there or even lower. But the way we are going ahead, 21% of women are obese or overweight, 19% of men are obese or overweight. That's the present reality as of today. When we come to eating, we all think weight is something, a balance between what we consume and what we burn out. If you burn out more, you lose weight. If you consume more, you put on weight. But if you believe that notion, if that is that way to be true, let's imagine we all have from today one extra ice cream a day, that probably 500 kilocalories in each ice cream wherever we eat. If you make it a habit to have one ice cream a day, you might be consuming around 3500 calories a week, that roughly about half kg. If you consume one ice cream, one habit change in your life, so by like half kg a week, that is 2 kgs a month, that is 20 kgs a year, like 200 kgs, I should be weighing 200 kgs in 10 years time, which is not true. In real life, eating one extra ice cream doesn't mean we put on 100 kgs. So that comes to what happens to our energy. So we roughly have 2500 calories every day, so into 30 days, into 12 months. So if you see, when we consume, 1 million calories pass by each one of us every year. So roughly that's what, but most of us, our weight might not change more than a kg here or there. So the typical change is only, 10,000 kilocalories. So between 1 million calories that pass by us every year, the change is around 10,000 calories. So that is a metabolic error we are talking about. So it's not just what we consume will decide what we eat, what weight we put on. So in this background, we know that heart diseases are common, diabetes is common, sleep apnea is common, malignancies are very common. So we end up losing 10 years of our life if we are obese. So this is the risk we are taking. So Mehar Prasad has talked about environmental factors, the mind, and other things. Genetics, I think, lose around 20 kgs. Probably the gut hormones do have a play, like ghrelin. Ghrelin is called hunger hormone. We are all having a lot of ghrelin. If we test our ghrelin levels now, it will be more than 500. Usually below 200 is normal. So okay. Of all these 5 hormones, ghrelin will make you put on weight. All other 4 hormones are satiety hormones. They make you feel full. So these 4 hormones make us feel full whenever we start eating. Though we might be equally hungry now, but when we start eating, some of us will end up eating more compared to others. That's satiety. You feel full with small servings. Some of us need extra servings to make ourselves full. So leptin is nothing to do with gut hormone. Leptin is similar to insulin. If you see, type 2 diabetes insulin levels are high and you need insulin to bring down the sugars. In the same way, leptin levels are high in obese subjects and giving leptin injections will bring their weight down. So you can more or less compare it to insulin molecule in terms of, as I said, in diabetics insulin levels are high, in obese leptin levels are high. So giving leptin will cause weight loss. But that's not a gut hormone. Ghrelin I was talking about. Ghrelin. When we were in Hammersmith, we used to do human infusion studies. We used to infuse ghrelin in cancer patients to improve their appetite. Ghrelin is a hunger hormone. It's produced in the stomach. So peptide YY is a satiety hormone. It's produced in the intestine cells. Glucagon GLP-1, we all know, it's another satiety hormone. So apart from hormones, the other new concept about gut microbes. This is a new evolving concept. Basically, the bacteria in the intestines are involved in contributing towards obesity. So there is a lot of change of bacteria, gut bacteria, as a contributing factor. towards obesity. This is a new thing. They did, this is my, one of my last two slides. So what they did is in mice, like they, when they are probably not exposed to the society. So what they have found is when the obese mice was exposed to this group, the obesity levels in the, in these mice were very high. So basically gut microbes do contribute towards obesity. And there's a lot of research going on into that direction. So mice that received fecal transplant from obese donors not only became obese, but do so by eating less food. Whether they, whatever they consume, they end up putting weight. So obesity, the gut microbes do play a role. I think I'll stop here. Thank you.
I think Dr. Shyam has given us a good view that the gut has an important role to play in causing obesity and also in management of obesity. Has highlighted the importance of all these hormones. But I would still like to invite Dr. Maya Prasad to see whether he would like to say something in response to this.
Thank you, Dr. Sahai. I do agree with Dr. Shyam in that these hormones are all there which control the appetite and satiety and all those sort of things. That is in a normal situation. Okay. But so if that is the, if that alone has the only thing which controls it, then people having undergoing bariatric surgery, we do see them putting on weight. So my argument would be in normal situation, in a, when God produced the human, perfect human being, this is how he produced him. But he gained artificial intelligence. Man gained artificial intelligence. So now he uses his brain to eat, not the gut to eat. So that's the problem now. So that's where the, so, and the gut, the artificial intelligence has an overreaching effect on the gut hormones and all the other pathways which is in the, involved in these, in the brain gut adipose tissue hypothesis. So that is my way of looking at it. And we also see in practical experience, unless, I mean, the management of obesity, psychologists play a very important role. They have to train them to eat the right food, right portions. So my view would be that mind has a major role. Yes, gut has its own role as well, but mind is an overreaching role. That's how I put it.
As a surgeon, sir, I think my point of view would be both gut and brain have equal role to play. I think no one place wins over the other. I think both are culprits in the obesity, and to treat obesity, even the obesity surgery part of it also, requires training of the mind as well as controlling the gut. So it's not just the gut nor the brain, but I think it's the both combined together.
Yeah, I totally agree with this concept that both the brain and also the gut microflora would help in tackling these issues of obesity or diabetes or whatever it is. So controlling both the things could be very useful in getting these things normalized. Thank you.
We can stop here.